I'll play you the original version.
Knew the signs wasn't right. I was stupid for a while, swept away.
But to me, there was a lot of differences, the drum difference. So it just shows that, you know, we should have just stuck to it. But the other part of the brief was, if there was two sides to it, was because it was being used in a film. The interesting bit was that both the producer and record company said, oh, we can't make this too epic, because if we make it really epic, the ideal thing to sell the song was to have it in the film at some of the main bits. Now, obviously, in the film, they're going to be talking and stuff like that. So the other thing was, if we made it too big anywhere or made it too grand, we were worried that it was going to detract from their film. So we had to make something quite simple that would just be very jolly in the background and that wouldn't interfere with that, so that it would get prime position. Because we knew, you know, we weren't silly. They must have asked three or four people, probably, to pitch songs for the main track, because it was going to be their big film for the year. So that was something else we had to take into account, which doesn't normally, only when you're doing that kind of specific thing, you get asked. So therefore, when we went back to record it, we approached it even more simply, and we thought about it. And the guy in the record company, the A&R guy, he's a big fan of soul, old soul music and stuff. And he said, look, I want it to sound really kind of simple and organic and a bit old fashioned, just really kind of, just very, very basic. So we went into Metropolis Studios and we set up all live. We had drummer, bass player, guitarist and keyboard player was in the control room, and just recorded it in two takes. Used the second take. Guitarist just then went back in and played in a couple of little fill lines. The drums were recorded on, I recorded kick, snare, hat, ride, and I had two individual mics just placed around the kit, and I just moved them around until they sounded good. And in the mix, we just used the kick, the hat, and one of the individual mics. That was on three mics. So it was just really simple and old school. Didn't individually mic the toms or anything, because just wanted to give it that old sort of characteristic sound, and they loved it. So that's kind of how we did it. I mean, if you see the track split here, I think, if I was to the top, that's the old version. Kick, snare, hat, kit one. Oh, there was a room mic and there was a ride mic, but they wouldn't have been used. And I remember we only used one of the kit mics, because I remember as we were recording it, one of the kit mics sounded better. And when we did the overdubs and the vocals, we always had the balance with that. But when we came to do the final mix, I switched the mics and the other one sounded better in the mix. It just sounded a bit more in context with everything else once all the other music was on there. So we ended up going with that. And that's the other thing I found with Pro Tools. When we used to work on Tape Machine, we had 24 tracks to play with. So you used to have to make a lot of decisions as you went along. So if I was working on this, if we were recording a band and we had kick, snare, hat, our two kit mics, a room, and the ride, that's already seven tracks gone. Bass, stereo, Wurlitzer, guitar, lead vocal, 13 tracks. We've still got, 12 tracks left. Probably have time code to run some kind of automation on the computer, seven tracks. So you're very limited to what overdubs you can put on. So you have to make the decisions. Now I find Pro Tools, 100 odd tracks, people throw stuff on and think, oh, I'll sort it out in the mix. Or I'll put that down in case I need it. And oh, I'll just do that. And I get stuff to mix. I get stuff from this American guy all the time, and he has everything has over 100 tracks on it, and it's kind of, and sometimes there's a second session because there's too much stuff, and it's like, well, maybe some of that, and it's just, so you spend a day trying to sift through it, and by the time you've sifted through it, you're bored of the song, and you've lost the spontaneity of it. If when you had 24 tracks, and the producer had made the decisions as he went, even backing vocals, often what we'd do is we'd maybe record 6 tracks of backing vocals, and then get a balance on the desk, bounce them back down to either one track, and then do another 6, doubling it, and bounce those to another track, and then you just have stereo backing vocals, but it's made up of 12 parts, and all the balance would be pre-made. Now, everyone tends to keep it separate, which is good, because it means in the mix, you can do more things, and you can change the balance at a later date, but it creates for more work. And sometimes that work is just a bit time-consuming and a bit unnecessary. So it's great, 24 tracks, just push the faders up, and you start mixing, and it's really spontaneous and quick. And you can probably get the mix going within about 3-4 hours, you've got the bulk of it. Whereas some days I'm still on the computer after 6 or 7 hours, and I'm still trying to work out what everything is, and people don't label stuff. So if you're gonna be an engineer and record stuff, please label it, because you're not always gonna be the one mixing it. It might go somewhere else. So as much information as you give them, it really helps.
You're still mixing out of the box, or you do everything on the computer?
No, I mean, that, as you heard it, obviously the mixes are just a finished mix I've imported. Those faders are just lined up, and it's just coming out backwards 1 and 2, because when we did the mix, everything came out of its own outputs, coming up a console. It was mixed on a J-series, that track, SSL J-series. Depends on the project. Sometimes I'll mix in the box, but recently I've been over at Strong Room mixing through the Neve. They've got a Neve VR. I've been mixing through the console, allowing that to summit. So I tend to put all my faders at 0, and then everything comes up individual channels. If I find that something's coming out of the box too loud and overloading, I'll back it down in the box, or if it's too low. Or sometimes what I might do is, if I'm mixing, say I'm mixing a rock band, and the basic rhythm section of the tracks is going to be the same for each song thereabouts, because it's the same drummer and same bass player in the same room, and it's all rocky. Once I've got, I might have an external compressor patched across the bass. When I load the next track up, I might keep the compressor threshold the same and adjust the input into it from there, so that then if ever we have to go back and do it, the system doesn't have to recall the compressor. It will just come back from there exactly and hit the compressor at the right level.
And would you use some stuff, like some plugins in specific tracks as well?
Yeah, I would. I would use, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, you can't beat great sounding outboard EQ, but because it has characteristics that they still haven't quite got there. They're getting much better, and it's getting really close. The slight disadvantage of that is they tend to differ. So you get one Fairchild compressor. I hate to think what they cost now, if you can even buy one, because they're like gold dust. I'd say you'd probably pay about £15,000-£20,000. They sound great, but if it hasn't been looked after, it's got valves in, if the valves are knackered, if it's not a good one, it's not going to sound great. So a lot of people make the thing of, oh, the studio's got a Fairchild, I'm going to put Fairchild on, it'll sound great. Sometimes you put it on, it doesn't. Whereas at least these ones sound very consistent. The Wave stuff is fantastic. A lot of their emulations are very good. And even what I found easy, even if they have a compressor that's supposed to sound like an outboard piece, sometimes it doesn't, but in its own right, it sounds quite good. And that's not a bad thing. It can still be really useful. I think the Universal Audio stuff is really good. A lot of their plugins sound very, very good. Their Pultec one, again, it's not as good as a real Pultec, but when you're doing a mix in the box and you start cranking it, it works really well, and you really notice it.